Hello, I'm Nicholas Hoare for Vermont PBS. I don't know about you, but I have a very soft spot for ants, particularly maiden ants. I had, in my callow youth, two great aunts of great eccentricity, one of whom, believe it or not, was the very first professor, lady professor, elected to her college at Cambridge. Roaring eccentrics, great characters, and I loved them both. I also had two real aunts that I was enormously attached to as well. They were my aunts. And while Pippin would not altogether agree with this extraordinary conversation, and indeed is making her exit, I have in my hand a lovely little book on this topic called The Complete Book of Aunts. It came out some years ago. You can still get it very easily, either in the library or on the internet. It's by a gentleman called Rupert Christiansen, who's, believe it or not, an expert on opera and writes for British newspapers. He put this thing out almost as a joke a decade or so ago, and it's become immortal. I'd like to take from the index an example of what he's on about, because it's really great, quite fun. The index itself says, a short history of the ant, mothering ants, literary ants, heroic ants, exotics and eccentrics, X-rated ants, damned bad ants, fairy tale ants, bargain ants, and so forth. And each chapter has these wonderful little anecdotes, which I will spare you, except for the following. Let us take, for example, Exotics and Eccentrics, Chapter 5. Imperious and impetuous, yet brusquely kind and briskly sensible with her quick, bright eye, mob cap and gentleman's watch, Betsy Trotwood provides a template for the benignly eccentric Victorian aunt. A contented spinster leading a life of militant independence, she takes in her orphan nephew David Copperfield when he runs away from London, sees off his persecutors, the ghastly Murdstone siblings, and then generously pays for his education and sets him up in the law. Dickens turns her into a mothering aunt. She rechristens David as Trotwood Copperfield, thereby implying her maternal claim. The softer emotions do not easily penetrate her defences, but what does crack through is sincere and heartfelt. You are my adopted child, she tells David. Only be a loving child to me in my age and bear with my whims and fancy. David duly reciprocates with all love and respect, and the novel rewards her with a happy, active old age. We last see her 40 years and more, but upright yet, and a steady walker of 6 miles at a stretch in winter. Then you have X-rated aunts. In my student days, I remember a Casanovan friend confiding that he did prevent his physical ardour from reaching an overhasty conclusion by forcing himself at the crucial moment to envisage a row of overfilled dustbins. A lineup of his elderly aunts might well have performed a similar function, for sex and aunts don't go together. Indeed, they seem to cancel each other out, as they do in the absurdly oxymoronic title of Mavis Cheek's novel The Sex Life of My Aunt, 2002, though what the story actually shows is how wrong one can be in one's assumptions about the respectability of elderly relations. On we go. This is called Damned Bad Aunts. To be sure, aunts of all kinds are damn bad things, complains Tony Lumpkin in Oliver Goldsmith's comedy, She Stoops to Conquer. P.G. Woodhouse's Bertie Wooster would have fervently agreed. Both fellows, of course, are great boobies, prize chumps, and laughingstocks. This book prefers to present aunts in a positive light, as beacons of a civilizing, loving kindness at one remove from the intensely emotional power struggle that underlies parenthood. But we must not sentimentalize. Tony's and Bertie's viewpoint must be given its due. There are aunts of all kinds at all times and all places who are indeed damn bad things. This is a delight, and indeed, if you have an aunt with a sense of humour, that is, this is something to pop into her Christmas stocking with a big sloppy kiss. It's a great nonsense, and I love it dearly, and it's the sort of thing that fits extremely well if you have, by any chance, a loo that's on the go and doesn't have a book in it. It's a perfect size, as you can see, eminently holdable, very fun, and I think you'll have a giggle or two. I certainly did. And on that rather silly note, good afternoon.